Einen schönen guten Abend. Ich freue mich, dass Sie den Weg zur Heinrich-Böll-Stiftung heute gefunden haben. Wir führen diese Veranstaltung auf Englisch durch, deshalb mache ich jetzt auf Englisch weiter. My name is Beate Adolf and I'm the Program Coordinator in the Africa Department at the Foundation. At first I want to thank Bread for the World, who is co-hosting this event. Let me introduce Jan Papendiek, hello. He's responsible for Nigeria and Benin at Bread for the World. And he informed us that Nnimmo Bassey is in Europe this November. And as we have partnered with Nnimmo before, we were very happy to bring him here and to have the space today for this event. A warm welcome also to Sarah Lincoln, policy advisor at Bread for the World, and the two panelists will be further introduced by Dagmar Dehmer in an instant. Let me also greet Dagmar Dehmer. We are lucky that she can be here this evening as a political editor at the Berlin daily newspaper, Der Tagespiegel. She covers environmental issues with a focus on climate change and energy transition. And in 2010, she received the German Environment Media Reward of the German Umwelthilfe. Secondly, she is reporting from and on the Global South, focusing on Africa, a lot on Africa as well, and there also especially Kenya and Nigeria. So we could not have found a better match. Welcome, Dagmar Dehmer. Although Nigeria faces many challenges, tonight we hope to highlight a positive example when we hear about the cleaning up of the Ogoniland. We have planned the evening as a talk on the panel and we'll give room for questions from you after. And after the discussion, we can have some drinks and pretzels down the stairs. So without further ado, I hand over to Dagmar. Thank you.
Warm welcome from me too. Before we sit on the on that stage, we want to show you something so you have an idea what Nnimmo soon will be talking about. It is a small part of a film which shows you some scenes from the Ogoni region and how the oil looks like there. I give you more information after we saw it.
Shifting weather patterns are
So der Film, den Titel haben Sie ja gesehen, Nowhere to Run. Der wurde produziert von der Yar Adua Foundation. Now I'm in German, sorry. So the film, the title you saw is Nowhere to Run. It was produced by the Yar Adua Foundation in Abuja, and it was shown the first time about a year ago. And at the beginning, you saw the host, Kensaro Viva Jr. The name, of course, everybody remembers, at least the elder people remember, because during the dictatorship, the father was killed in connection with the struggle against Shell and the oil spills. And the son recently passed away too. Everybody was quite shocked about that. So we at least had a small, vivid image of him coming to us. So, and one person you already saw in the film is Nnimmo Bassey, one of the prominent voices from Nigeria when it comes to environmental topics, especially what the oil industry causes. But not only, he has a broader view on environmental topics. He's the head of the Health and Mother Earth Foundation, which he set up 3 years ago. And before, he was for a long time actually the environmentalist in Nigeria you would ever hear of, and that hopefully will last for a long time on. So he will start with his statement soon. And the second panelist comes from Bread for the World, and she's Sarah Lincoln. She's a lawyer. No, not a lawyer, but she studied law, but maybe she is even a lawyer. And she's now working for Bread for the World as policy advisor on the topics of economic and social rights, and especially the question which responsibility do companies have when they conduct business somewhere else. We in Germany have a discussion about an action plan about human rights and companies and which responsibilities they should have. That discussion, of course, is a global discussion, and so Sarah will give us some insight into how the debate is going and which kind of responsibilities companies should take for their actions. But we start with Nnimmo Bassey.
Thank you very much, and thank you for coming out tonight. The clips that we saw provides quite a picture of what the situation is in the Niger Delta. And the pictures from the pollution are all from Ogoni land. Ogoni is a territory. It's also the name of a language and the name of the people group. So Ogoni is both land, culture, and everything. So when we say Ogoni land, we're actually over tautology. It's like saying land, because Ogoni is already Ogoni land. So the Ogoni people are about 1 million population, and they were the first to have a real organized environmental justice movement fighting for the rights of because it's an ethnic minority. We're having minimum of 250 ethnic nationalities in Nigeria, and Ogoni is just one of the tinier ones. By the time Kensarawewa was leading the movement there, there were 500,000 people. But now the population has doubled, more or less. So the experience of the Ogoni, the struggle of Ogoni, clearly shows that it's not how many people are, but how resolved they are to fight against environmental crimes. Because in 1990, the Ogoni issued the Ogoni Bill of Rights, which they sent to the Nigerian government at that time, making clear demands for a cleanup of Ogoni land. This was in 1990, making demands for Ogoni people to have to be given political space, economic space, to be respected, and all the demands you normally make of a nation of people who want to take their destiny in their hands. But that Bill of Rights was not addressed by the military. By 1993, the people marked the first Ogoni National Day in January 1993. And one of the resolutions of that major conference gathering was that Shell should leave their territory. And that is when oil extraction stopped in Ogoniland. So 23 years after, not one single drop of oil is being extracted from Ogoniland. But we still have pollution because there are pipelines crossing the territory towards the export terminal. And those pipelines do erupt from time to time for one reason or the other and cause more pollution. And some older pollutions that have occurred already are still yet to be cleaned up. So that's the background to the rise in nationalism, Ogoni nationalism, so to speak. But by 1994, some Ogoni chiefs were killed. And then Kensarwiwa and nine other Ogoni leaders were accused of being responsible. But they were not. It was just a kangaroo set up by the military to eliminate the leadership in Ogoni. And on 10th November 1995, just before then, they were sentenced to death. Nine of them were sentenced to death. One was freed. And they were given a period of time to appeal against the judgment. But before the period of appeal expired, they were executed by the Nigerian military on 10th November 1995. But that did not mean that Shell could go back to reopen their oil fields in Ogoniland. No. The demands of the people stands, and although there was a massive crackdown on the people, a lot of Ogoni went into exile. Some still live in exile. There's an Ogoni community in Benin Republic. They've not returned to Nigeria. They're just there. They're stuck out of the country. So it was really a very traumatic period for Ogoni, the Ogoni people. And that was the first time the military actually occupied a territory in the Niger Delta. But now the military have occupied everywhere in the Niger Delta. If you take a boat ride in the creeks, maybe I don't know whether you've done that. If you go on a boat ride in the creeks, wherever oil pipelines cross the creeks, you have military surveillance team like a checkpoint behind sandbags. And what happens is that if you go in a canoe or boat or whatever in the creeks, whenever you get too close to where the military are, they have to switch off the engine and then steer the boat to where the military are, with everybody having their hands up in the air, which is very humiliating. And I personally feel violated each time I travel in the creeks, because I have to lift up my hands, otherwise they will shoot me. So everybody just lift up, and you can't put down your hands until they tell you to keep down your hands. See, you are on territory, in your own village, you are just going home. Maybe you're coming from the market. So the military, starting from the assault and occupation of Ogoni territory, have worked very closely with the corporations to suppress the rights of the people, to silence dissent, and of course to work behind military shields to exploit without any sense of responsibility or accountability. Now, so this is going on all over the Niger Delta, not just Ogoni territory. In 2016, this is this year, 2006, the government agreed to have the Ogoni environment assessment of Ogoni environment. And UNEP, United Nations Environment Program, was commissioned to carry out that study. And they began to carry out the study from 2009 and completed the study in 2011. The report was submitted to the government in 2011, August 4. And August 4 has become like a milestone for protests and for remembrance, because every year people wait to see something happen and nothing is happening. So every August 4 is now a date for mobilization for Ogoni cleanup. But on August 4 this year, just as people were preparing to mobilize again, of course, there was still a certain level of mobilization. the government set up the governing structures for the cleanup of Ogoniland. On June 2nd this year, there was a ceremonial flag off, a big ceremony that the cleanup is going to start. But there was no structure to back up that announcement. So the announcement now came. The structure was announced and populated on August 4, 2016. Now, the extent of the pollution in Ogoniland, if you've read the UNEP report, you can find it online, Environmental Assessment of Ogoniland. It shows really that it shows the depth of the pollution and the fact that and the steps to be taken to clean it. There are short-term emergency measures, short-term measures, medium-term measures, and long-term measures. And the whole process would include not just remediation, but restoration. Remediation may take the period that would a number of years, but to restore the environment will take quite a long time. Case in point is the Alaska Exxon Valdez accident in Alaska in 1989. That spill was very vigorously attacked and cleaned up, but up to date, some species, some aquatic life species that were affected by the oil spill have not returned there. So it takes a long, long time to restore the ecosystem after a spill has occurred. And of course, there were challenges with the cold weather and everything, but the Niger Delta is even more fragile because a lot of the spills are in swampy areas, some are in forest, and of course, a lot in the water. If you visit the communities, but if you just step into the communities, you would know that the air you are breathing is loaded with hydrocarbons. And you would usually, most people would develop, visitors would develop a headache within a few moments of being there. But people are living right there. So the cleanup has been a major campaign issue. And we're expecting that the cleanup of Ogoniland would be the beginning point for the cleanup of the entire Niger Delta. Because although the corporations always say they clean up when spills occur, those cleanup are just fancy talks. They're not no reality. In the past, it used to be that I would say that response to oil spill is a bit better now than before. Because in the past, you could have a spill going on for up to a month, and there would be no step at all to even stop it. And my comment then used to be that if really Nigeria was producing a certain amount of crude oil, like 2.2 billion million barrels a day, and then you have oil spills with so many barrels leaking and nobody stopping it, then it really meant that we were producing far more than what we said we were producing. And many political commentators and politicians and leaders have confirmed this. Some years back, the Nigerian Minister of Finance said that at least 500,000 barrels of crude oil are stolen every day. I've heard some people mention the figure up to 1 million. Nobody's really sure exactly how much, but it's very clear that a lot of barrels have been stolen every day. And this is not stolen by the poor guys you see on TV news clips carrying buckets with crude oil. You can't steal 500,000 barrels of crude oil with buckets. It's impossible. It's a syndicate that is operating there, where these things are taken into they're exported and sold abroad, out of the country, out of the territory, completely. So the small people in the communities cannot really handle that kind of systemic plunder of the resources of the region. Now, coming back to the issue of the cleanup. In 2012, at the first anniversary of the submission of the report, UNEP report, the government then actually set up what they call the Hydrocarbons Pollution Restoration Project. And we said, well, we don't want to restore pollution. We want to remediate or clean up the pollution. Don't come to restore pollution. Nobody wants to restore any pollution. It was that body that set up the signposts you saw in the documentary. They're all over Ogoniland, and they spent a big chunk of resources just putting the signposts around the territory, and no cleanup, no option, no emergency water supply. And unfortunately, till date, there's really no emergency water supply. People are still drinking water that is heavily polluted. And this is why some of us are concerned, and we're insisting that the cleanup should not just be a political announcement, but should be effectively carried out. And I should just confess at this point that I'm a member of one of the boards to oversee the cleanup and represent the civil society. And I agree to do that because we need to see from the inside and be and hold the system accountable for this promise that they've made for to clean up Ogoni land. But that board was inaugurated on the 4th of August, and people are getting quite impatient about the cleanup. Why has it not started? You have the governing body, you have the board of trustees. What is really going on? But you know, it is really not as easy as picking up a shovel and shoveling some crude oil away. There are a lot of, so I actually understand that it will take some time to set up, get the proposals and examine the proposals, get the technical manpower required to administer the cleanup and be sure that it's done, because the governing boards are not made up of technical experts. We're just like people to give an oversight. So you need technical team to actually handle the day-to-day running of the cleanup. And then it's going to require a lot of labor. So even as the UNEP report recommended, setting up of centers of excellence for soil management, pollution restoration, you need to train people, local manpower, who would be involved, who would be utilized as labor force for the cleanup to be successful. Because you simply cannot import the labor force to handle the job of that magnitude. Then the last thing I would like to mention before I drop the ball is that there's a lot of expectation. There's also a lot of anxiety. And every moment as the days go by, people are really getting very impatient. There are many reactions and action related to this, including other parts of the Delta where pollution is still ongoing. They're very worried about their own land remaining polluted. But the idea is that Ogoni would be the starting point, almost like a place to learn. Because we are talking about some pollution, there's a place, if you visit Ogoni, there's a place where an oil spill occurred in early 1970s, either 1971 or 72, and that spill is still there. In fact, there is fenced round partially, and you have military personnel watching over the location. And some part have hardened, like almost like coal, but that is there, that needs to be dealt with. And some parts of Ogoni land, the pollution goes as deep as 5 meters, according to the UNEP report. 5 meters into the soil. So that is going to be a massive operation to try to be able to restore that kind of land. So we're having it's a real complicated issue. So the question you may ask is, why? How did this happen? And why was it not stopped? I guess you all have answers to that question. But let's just say that there's this unholy wedlock between the corporation and the military. And the military was in power in Nigeria for 30 solid years. And the corporation benefited from the military being in power for so long, because one of the heads of Shell in Nigeria said once that for them as a business, they prefer to have a stable business environment, and dictatorships provide that stability. So it became very clear that under the military, they could do whatever they wanted and get away with it. And so it was very convenient for them to amass profits and damage people's lives, damage the environment, and then actually damage the fabric of society. Because right now, some of the things going on, like vandalism or sabotage or whatever, it's not something that people would ordinarily want to do. But when people have lost confidence in the system, confidence in government, confidence in corporations, and they feel that they're just left, the resources are being taken above from their communities, that they get nothing in return. They feel that they have nothing to lose, and they just have to vent their anger in the way that we're seeing. But that is quite damaging to the ecosystems, and we have a doubly difficult job to do, campaigning against a corporate irresponsibility, campaigning against government's insensitivity, and then again campaigning against young comrades who feel that they have to do something dramatic to capture attention. And if they do get attention, not just of the government, but also the corporations, the international community. And the attention they're getting is that sometimes to settle the quarrel, they get paid a lot of money. And when you tackle militancy with money, then you are sowing the seeds for further future militancy. It's like, so it's kind of, we were looking for a solution that could actually put an end to the rot in the territory. And one of it, by my analysis, would be to actually begin a process of cleanup so that people could see that, well, 58 years we've been living in pollution, getting nothing at all, but at least now we can begin to have our environment back. And that would mean restoration of livelihoods, because, I think I should round up here, but let me just say this. The UNEP report is very nice, but there are some things I don't agree with in it at all. For example, after studying 5,000 health records, they couldn't draw a conclusion between the pollution and the health of the people. They said they had to do further analysis before they could draw that conclusion. I think that was just too nice. That was a very nice way of trying to avoid pointing fingers at anybody. And secondly, the report said that we didn't have much fish in the waters in Ogoni because the Ogoni people have overfished. And I think that is really stupid. But that's a scientific document. How could you find rivers covered with crude oil, and then you say this, you don't have enough, you don't have much fish there because of overfishing? It's simply not true.
That reminds me of other UN reports when it comes to health. It's always very complicated for them. I mean, that radiation might have a health impact is still an ongoing discussion, at least on the UN level. But that happens with the UN. So I would ask Sarah to step in and give the roundup from the other perspective.
I just have, before I start, actually one question, Nnimmo. Maybe could you say a few words about who's actually paying for the cleanup project? Because that's quite related to my subject, and I'm sure you know more detailed figures on that.
Maybe I have the money in my pocket also. All right. I should have mentioned that. The cleanup, the United Nations Environment Program recommended that $1 billion will be needed to set up the structure and begin the cleanup process. And that should be realized in 5 years. So the polluters are to produce $200 million every year for the first five years. To set up the process, that's because the process is going to take about 30 years anyway. So this is just to set up the beginning, and because oil companies operate under joint venture partnerships with the Nigerian state, the Nigerian state is a player in all the operations. Although the oil companies hold a minor shares, not as much as the government, but the oil companies are the operators, so they actually call the shots. And they determine how much it costs to do whatever. And so they include everything, including the food they eat and the toothpick they use as part of production cost of crude oil, which they deduct before. So they make a hell of a lot of money, even though it's a joint venture. So the money for the cleanup is to be shared in the proportion of the joint venture. And in the case of the oil fields in Ogoniland, the government holds a share of 55%. So the government is going to produce 55% of the money, and Shell is producing 30% of the money. I think Total is produced to provide 10%, and so on and so forth. And is Shell paid for the assessment by UNEP, the $9+ million, and they said they paid it on the basis of pollution-based principle, which clearly shows an admission of guilt. So they admitted. So the cleanup also is to be paid for on the basis of polluter-based principle.
Yeah, okay, thanks a lot. As mentioned, I work on the issue of business and human rights, so looking at what companies are actually responsible for in their operations abroad, and that's why I think it's an important aspect that Shell is the main operator and is also contributing to this cleanup project, because obviously the first question that comes to the mind is, okay, companies that have been producing or causing this pollution should obviously be part of cleaning it up. And I think actually this cleanup project, which has still to get going and start, but I think it's good and it's hopeful, and I hope it moves forward. And at the same time, I would still like to say that obviously this financial contribution by the companies to this cleanup shouldn't be letting them off the hook for pollutions that they have been causing and still are causing, not only in Ogoniland, but also in the surrounding areas. And as far as I understand, there are still ongoing a few hundred spills every year, and that by Nigerian law, the operators are responsible to clean up these spills in their operations and compensate affected people. So I've been looking at some of the studies, or at least the studies that I have seen, have come to the conclusion that Shell in the past has been maybe saying that it's been doing some cleanup, but most of the cleanup that it claims to have done hasn't actually led to to remediation or actually cleaning up the land. So for at least the Amnesty report that came out last year came to the conclusion that Shell's cleanup so far has been completely ineffective and continues to be so, and that pollution is continuing. So I think even with the positive outlook of this cleanup project, we have to have in mind that operations are continuing and pollution is continuing, and the companies have to be held accountable. And so far, this has been very difficult. So basically, what we saw is there's a problem of oil spills, but also of gas flaring. So oil spill is one problem, but gas flaring is another ongoing problem that is not going to be tackled by the cleanup project. And I think a problem that is quite common also in other countries is that monitoring in Nigeria is weak. As I heard, the fines are very low. Court cases court proceedings are often not objective, are often corrupted by the companies, take a long time. So what's happening is that it's been very difficult to hold the companies accountable in Nigeria for the pollution caused by oil spills, but also for making them stop the gas flaring. Because actually, I don't know if Nnimmo mentioned that or the film, but it's been forbidden since the 80s and is still a quite normal practice that's going on. And at the same time, it's also very difficult to hold companies accountable in the countries from where they operate. So Shell, for example, is an Anglo-Dutch company, and there have been some court cases against Shell in UK and Netherlands. And the Netherlands case is still ongoing, and it might be a success. There have also been successes in the UK, but generally it is quite difficult to make a case that the parent company is responsible for what its subsidiaries are doing in the operating country, because basically all companies function by subsidiaries, or there's complicated structures of joint ventures. And so legally, you have legally very separate entities that can always push the responsibility from the one to the other. So the parent company will always say, it's not me, it's actually my subsidiary, even though actually they know exactly what's going on the ground, and they're profiting financially from the operations that are causing the pollution. This sort of constellation is not unique to Nigeria, and I'm actually no expert on the oil exploitation in Nigeria. So I've been working on many cases of mining, for example, coal mining, copper mining, gold mining, platinum mining in Asia, Africa, Latin America, where we see exactly the same problem. So mining operations where parent companies sit in Switzerland, in UK, in Canada, in China, causing water pollution, causing forced evictions from land, but at the same time, the problem that these corporations are collaborating with military, with police, to suppress any sort of protest you see on the ground by affected people, and therefore making it very difficult for people to actually rise up and hold the companies accountable in their countries, but for the reasons I was mentioning, making it nearly impossible to go to Canada, Switzerland, or UK to hold these companies accountable. So this is not a problem unique to Nigeria or Netherlands or UK. So, and I think this is where we come to the more general problem, or also to the responsibility of the home state. So if I say it's difficult to go to Switzerland, to UK, to Netherlands to say, hey, the company in your country is causing human rights violations, pollution abroad, and the courts will actually then come to the conclusion, no, it's the subsidiary. This is where the government should be stepping in and creating a legal system, filling these legal gaps and making it clear, okay, companies registered here should be made legal, or should be legally obliged to respect human rights, to respect the environment when they're operating abroad. So that's why there's a strong push at the moment in Europe, but also in Canada, to develop or establish laws that would then make parent companies responsible for the impacts of their operations, also those caused by subsidiaries or even along supply chains if they have a strong relationship to the supplier. And at the moment, governments are completely resistant to this idea and are putting the emphasis on voluntary approaches. So they're saying, yes, we do believe that our companies should be acting responsibly, they shouldn't be polluting in other countries, but we believe that it's sufficient to appeal to them to do so and not to create a legal obligation. And the reason why it's being so difficult to persuade governments to introduce new laws is that the international framework is also voluntary. So the problem is that for years and years, decades actually, there's been a struggle at the United Nations to say, oh, look, we have a globalized economy, so we need binding international standards to have rules that will count for that will apply to companies acting globally. And it hasn't succeeded. So the compromise was that 2011, we got the UN Guiding Principles on Business and Human Rights adopted by the Human Rights Council. And as I said, these are voluntary principles. What they do make very clear is what I've been saying, that companies do have a responsibility to respect human rights. And this also means respect for environment, because I think Nnimmo in the film has made it very clear environmental pollution affects human rights, and states have an obligation to regulate. But because this is voluntary, Germany, for example, they've said, okay, great, we'll put that into an action plan, and Germany, the German government has been developing this action plan to implement these guiding principles for the last 2 years. They're going to present it maybe next week or the week after. We're still waiting. We've been very involved. We've been trying to get them to develop a law that would then regulate companies. So they haven't been buying into that. It's going to be, in the end, a more voluntary approach again. I can go into more detail on that later. So I think what we see here is a very basic problem, that starting from the international level, a very voluntary approach that the governments are putting into on the national level, again, a voluntary approach, so that companies actually fall into a legal gap where they're not being held account where they're operating due to weak regulatory systems, but not being held in account either in the countries from where they're operating. In the case of Shell, we will see what happens in some of the court cases, so there might be a positive outcome there, but these are only very few of the pollutions that that Shell has been causing. And so it's on one positive note, ending on a positive note, I think what's a little bit more hopeful at the moment is that recently there's a new initiative at the United Nations. So due to very strong pressure from grassroots movements, from NGOs all over the world saying this can't go on, we need binding standards for business, there's a new intergovernmental working group that was initiated by Ecuador that's been meeting, it's met now the second time, that is supposed to develop a binding treaty on business and human rights. And I think it's very important. We need this binding treaty. Problematic is that quite a few of the important states where a lot of big business is situated are skeptical. Europe is very skeptical. Japan, Korea, Canada, US, they're not going to get involved. So we need to keep pushing on this, because in the end, I think what we really need is an international effort to close these gaps, because otherwise business are always going to try and take advantage of countries where regulatory systems are low, and it's always going to be a race to the bottom, because these states are dependent on investments and they're not going to be scaling up regulation or monitoring, because that will mean business will move somewhere else. So
we'll pose one or two questions to you and then we'll open up and we come into a conversation. Nnimmo, I would like to pick up an issue Sarah was already asking about when it comes to finance. After the high-flying oil price in the 2008 to even 11, 12, the oil price now is very low, and that means that those extracting the oil are not earning a lot of money. And some of the investments are not, economic anymore. And in Nigeria, we have a special situation that the Nigerian state is involved in oil extraction since a long time, but only has, I think, one or two refineries, and the rest of the crude is exported, refined somewhere else, and then brought back, but still sold with a lot of subsidies and actually traded all over Africa, to tell you the truth. So that means there's not much money made with oil for the state right now, but even for the big oil companies. Does that change anything at the approach of the cleanup project in Ogoni? And to add something more, in 2008 I visited Shell in, I think it was in Abuja, and we had a conversation about the situation in Ogoni, and they showed us photos of their cleanup efforts. And it was really ridiculous, because they were showing us some people with white rubber boots and buckets and said, this is the cleanup.
That is high tech.
So that might be an explanation why the cleanup was not very effective. But maybe you can give us an idea what the finances mean and what efforts you already saw.
I was actually very happy when oil prices collapsed, because we've been arguing for many years that Nigeria should leave the oil in the ground, keep it in the ground, and that, in fact, globally, that should stop extracting fossil fuels, because they bring more harm than good. People are concerned about how we're going to have energy. I think there will be a repercussion, of course. We're going to move, maybe we may not be able to move as fast as we do now, but we have to learn to do things differently. There's no real option about this. So I was happy again when the oil price collapsed, because I knew it would force Nigeria, the Nigeria state, to begin to think about how to do things differently, how to engage in more productive things, because the oil sector is not a high employer of labor. For us in Africa, most countries, about up to 90% of the investment in the oil sector is abroad, not in the countries involved. So you haven't a lot of the investment being put in other economies, not in the local economy. And many of the staff are just contract staff who are not even able to insist on certain labor rights because they don't want to lose the jobs that they have. So it's a very extremely exploitative system, and the revenue is collected by governments that have not been very transparent. So you find that countries could be rich, the GDP could be very high, but the reality on the ground is that people have been left behind. So having said that, that is a core belief I have, that all should be left in the ground. So Nigeria shouldn't look for how to earn much more money from oil. In the past, when even now, the government is thinking of giving out new licenses to increase production to 3 million barrels a day, if possible. But the truth is that if they can stop oil theft, you can double production. So you don't need to open new oil fields. You keep the present one, stop oil theft, and you get double the income you are getting now. So that would just solve the problem and stop the pollution. Now the cleanup effort or decision by the present government is in the context of the reality of the value of crude oil right now. So it's not as if they made a decision 3 years ago. They made a decision this year to embark on the cleanup. So they already knew that not much money is coming in from that connection. The challenge really is how the National Petroleum Company can meet its own part of the budget. And I've asked that question. I've seen, at a close distance, and what I've been, the assurance given is that they will meet the target. They will find a creative way of meeting the target, and I think they're capable of finding creative ways of meeting the target. And the oil companies have all said they will put the money on the table. So right now, I don't know why you're laughing. They have creative ways they could do a number of things, which I don't want to speculate on, but I do know that there are possibilities. We've heard about so many brilliant ideas about how to raise money these days, so it's possible. What we've been concerned with really is to get a solid commitment and to see the money, and I'm on the committee that will see the money when the money is on the table. So I'm watching very closely to see the money on the table. If the money is not on the table, I'm able to know that it's not on the table. So we know that the cleanup is just talk and not real. But so far, the Minister of Petroleum and the heads of the corporations have said that they're putting the money on the table. So arrangements are being made now for the receipt of the money. And should be able to give an update before the middle of next month, whether the money is on the table or not.
Was that fastened after the government changed the whole process, or was that something that was already ongoing with the old government?
The old government set up the hydrocarbons pollution restoration project, which I mentioned. 1 year after that process was set up to stop people from protesting that no action was being taken. So it was a political move. And then there was a whole structure with so many staff and nothing happened. A lot of money and a lot of debt left behind. Now, the present system is still called HyPREP, but it's now called Hydrocarbons Pollution Remediation Project. So at least the name has been cleaned up and the space opened up for a lot of community representatives to be on the panel, for civil society to be represented on these committees. And it was a campaign promise of President Buhari when he was campaigning, that if he's elected, he would clean up Ogoniland. So people reminded him, and he's doing it as part of his promises.
Yeah, that's good to know. It's good to know that change sometimes seems possible. Yeah, you said you give us an update. So I would like to ask Sarah one question, which is maybe rounding up the whole picture. You were talking about the especially mining operations, which bring a lot of human rights abuses and so on. And if you look at the reports that Global Witness is publishing since quite some years, you see that in these conflicts there are the most, killings of environmentalists, and a lot of abuse of the people trying to, at least make their voice heard. Is there, in your perspective, a way how the global civil society could push for better protection for those who try to fight? I mean, that might even be, at a certain point, again, actual for you, or people on the ground. So are there any possibilities to put a campaign in that direction, too?
Yeah, now it's on. Okay. So, I think that's a central aspect, because the problem that people that are affected and are joining up to movements to protest against these mining operations face such severe repression, and as the Global Witness reports show, also a large number of killings are occurring, especially in these mega projects. And I think where there's no civil society saying, hey, look, this is going the wrong way, or this is affecting our human rights, there's never going to be any change, because it has to come from the ground. So the whole idea of protection of human rights defenders is a central aspect that we've been lobbying for in the international treaty process. So making sure, okay, this has to be about people affected, and there have to be provisions in this treaty on how states should protect human rights defenders, how regulation on holding corporations accountable that collaborate, because usually it's a collaboration between state and corporation. So you find these people killed, nobody knows who's behind it, and then bit by bit you find out that there's like a whole network of police, military and companies that in the end have just paid someone to go out and get rid of the people that have been causing trouble. So I think it's important to keep that perspective up, and to make it clear also to some of the countries involved in this process that themselves are also very repressive against human rights defenders. Ecuador, for example, that this is a major question that needs to be addressed. And I think the other thing that has to continue is a global solidarity system. So, like, for example, Bread for the World is very active in protection of human rights defenders. As soon as someone in one of our partner organizations, and this happens regularly, is threatened, we put in place a whole system of calling embassies, of making the case visible, of helping with getting the person out of the country. And I think other organizations have similar responses, and this has to really strengthen, because when you have to make these threats visible and help in active support. So what we also do is support organizations like Frontline Defenders or PBI that are on the ground in specific protection programs, basically with the people as a sort of shield to stop these things happening.
Thank you. So I think we have an overview, and if you want, it's your turn. I think, do we have another microphone, or do you just take one of these? So who wants to step in? You just say your name. If you want to ask your question in German, I would translate it. That should not be a hindrance. Anybody? Yes. Just tell us who you are and whom you are posing your question or remark.
I'm Dida Meidemusch. I just wrote a dissertation in environmental politics. And I have a question for you. See, I really wonder about, like, Shell is such a big company and everybody kind of knows they do shady businesses in Germany, but we still go there. Apple, same thing. Everybody probably here has an iPhone. I wonder, like, I lived in Turkey a long time. I wonder, aren't you angry? Like, I'm really angry at those people who go to a döner and have a döner and so on. I'm really, really angry at them. Aren't you angry? Like, are you angry at people in the West just going and going to have their car and just filling up their gas so they can have, like, go to holiday or whatever?
You know, I wrote a poem in 1998 titled "We Thought It Was Oil, But It Was Blood." So when you fill up, sometimes you're filling up your tank, you're actually filling with blood, people's blood from somewhere. So because of, yeah, but I'm not angry at people, but I'm angry at the pollution, and I'm angry at the destruction of the environment. I'm angry at the loss of lives in the communities, and I feel this sense of solidarity with people, citizens around the world, because around the world people are standing up against corporations and all these kind of evil things and crimes that they're committing, but somehow the corporations have. There's this document, this cartoon clip called Story of Stuff. I don't know whether you've seen it. There's one clip that really, really stuck my memory. Governments are the shoeshine boys of corporations. So they're doing whatever, governments are doing whatever corporations want. It's like a new form of colonialism, with corporations colonizing, and they're getting bigger and bigger every day. But citizens in the world, look at what is going on in the U.S., are standing rock. People are there day and night, week after week, hundreds of people, and the state is attacking them. So this is just like the Ogoni. It's like people anywhere in the world. So I wouldn't be angry with citizens of rich countries, industrialized countries, because their corporations are doing this, but because they're doing it also at home. I was recently in Rhineland during the climate camp earlier this year. And I could see communities that are waiting to be destroyed so that they can extract coal. You destroy culture, history, everything. That's in Germany. They even had a ceremony to deconsecrate a church so that it could be destroyed. You know, when a church building is built, you normally pray and bless it and make it holy. So now to destroy, you have to make the building unholy for the sake of coal. I mean, to me, it shows that the crisis is something that citizens of the world have to rise up and be ready to suffer inconveniences, because things will change, of course. Things will change, and what we think are the most modern things that will become history in future. Just like the pyramid. Actually, it was fantastic when it was built. The pyramids in Egypt. The Ziggurat, the pyramids in Mexico. When they were built, they must have been marvels of the world. Some of the things we have now would just be like that, fossils in future. So why don't we, the issue is that we have to make the transition and not wait for an accident. That's the whole thing about keeping it in the ground.
Anybody else? Yes, a young man there.
Thank you very much. My name is Manuel Müller. I'm desk officer for Nigeria in the German Foreign Office. Thank you very much for this valuable contribution. I think it's very important to talk about human rights and also environmental issues. I have one question to a subject you raised, the amnesty program. If I understood you rightly, you said that the amnesty program is counterproductive. It leads to even more militancy, paying militants, that's what I understood, or I don't know if I understood it rightly. So what the Nigerian government should do to fight against this militancy, which is also one part of the problems now for the time being, causing a lot of oil being spilled off. And also a second thing you said, you could even multiply
oil the output.
Sorry?
The output of the oil. That
yeah,
is what you meant.
The output by fighting against oil theft. There also, I would be interested to know what, to your opinion, should the strategy of the government be? How could they do it? Because you are certainly not referring to a purely military solution, but to a more sustainable one. And there I would be interested to know how this could be done. Thank you so much.
Can we talk about it in the corridor? I'm joking. okay. Yes, the...
It's a live stream.
I know. Well, whatever I said is copyleft, so no problem. yes, the issue of oil theft first is really a big issue. And some years ago, a ship was arrested in the high seas with stolen crude, and the Navy took it into detention. They detained the ship, but the ship escaped from detention. And when it was found again in the high sea, it was loaded with seawater, not crude oil. Now, I mention this because if a ship that is, it's not a speedboat, it's not a sports car, it's a ship, escaped from naval detention, that speaks a lot. So the solution really is not military. Same with the solution against militancy is not military, because you are not really fighting an army. These are, it's like guerrilla warfare, and just a few people who are causing trouble here and there. So it's difficult to exterminate that. Even the Bush refineries that the military bomb is creating more ecological problems, because those structures can very easily be taken apart. You don't need to bomb them. Within a few minutes, you can dismantle the refineries in the bush. There's some contraptions that people are using to refine and sell the product. So the oil theft, number one step to tackle it would be to set up meters in all the oil fields that can measure the amount of oil being extracted real time, so that there could be independent verification of how much oil is coming from any of the fields. Now that is not, it's not on. There's nothing like that. So if you don't even know how much oil you are extracting, then you don't have a clue how much is being stolen. Yeah, this is why we have different figures. We had the former government, the Minister of Finance, as mentioned, said 500,000. The Minister of Petroleum said 160,000. Some politicians, there was somebody say 1,000,000, you know, 1 million barrels. They were mentioning different figures. So just setting up, and this is what I would recommend, if possible, the government of Germany can offer the Nigerian government, the Department of Petroleum Resources, to install the meters in the oil field and see if they accept it. That would be a major, major step towards knowing what we're extracting and what is being lost. And if what is extracting is known, we can easily compare to what gets to the end of the pipe and know whether something got lost in between. From the export terminal, compare the figure there with the figures in the field. But I think because it's in the interest of all the players in the sector not to really know what is going on, then this is why there's been no installation of meters. I asked some friends from Ghana some months ago how well the meters were doing their offshore platforms. And they told me that some were not functioning anymore. So I said, well, that sounds like Nigeria. So I hope they fix them now. Otherwise, we just, the oil keeps going. Then the issue of militancy. Actually, and I've written on this, I'm surprised that the amnesty worked. When the amnesty was announced in 2009, I was convinced it wouldn't work for a day. But it worked. And how did it work? Oil production almost went back to normal level because they had stopped blowing up pipelines, they stopped kidnappings, and that was because they were paying off the leaders of those militant groups. And then, of course, they sent the young people who returned their arms and said they were part of militants. Some were sent to learn a lot of skills. And do you know what some of them went to learn? Pipeline welding. Even underground pipeline welding. And I thought that was very cool. The idea was good so that they could be employed in the sector. I'm not saying they are responsible for anything, but the kind of sabotage going on is really sophisticated. Sometimes under 5 meters of water, you know, in high seas, you blow up, sabotage a pipeline in the seabed. That is not a thing that you do casually. So to succeed as in sabotage or in oil theft, you really have to have technical skills and the equipment and the money to fund the process, because it's not something you do like throw a grenade and then get it off. No, to steal the oil, you have to know how to tap into the pipes. So I thought it would fail, but it worked. But the moment the system changed and the people were being paid were not getting the pay, those who had contracts were not getting the contract, they were bound to get offended, to get angry. And then, of course, if you paid those who carried out armed actions, if you pay them so well, somebody else at a point in time wants also to be paid. So the person may not embark on that action today, but tomorrow he could easily do it and wait to see what's going to happen. This is why I think the best thing to stop the violence is actually environmental restoration. Because if the environment is clean and people see that it's being cleaned, leaders in communities and the poor citizens in the communities would want to defend their environment and say, look, we've got it back, don't destroy it again. And it will become very unattractive for young people with arms to start causing the pollution after the cleanup has taken place. So the cleanup, to me, is a signal that the environment can be restored, that livelihoods can be restored, and that people can breathe again and live again. And I think it's much better to invest in the cleanup than, of course, the government cannot run away from the amnesty now because they have to phase it out, but it has to be phased out. And phasing out means providing jobs to the young people as well as the cleanup exercise. I think these are the best strategies I can see.
Maybe that metering issue could be brought into the Nigeria Extractive Industry Transparency Initiative. I mean, that is a voluntary measure, but it is something that has quite some... as respected as things are respected in the context, but it is at least something where you could even from outside say, well, would that not be a good idea? Why don't you put that in? Why hasn't it been put in already?
They've said it, even officials have said, government officials have said that they don't know how much oil is extracted. I think the Extractive Industry Transparency Initiative has also mentioned it. And if I'm not mistaken, there's been an offer once to install those meters, which was not taken up. So I think there should be another offer.
There was another, yes.
My name is Jan Papenik. I am a program officer for Nigeria in Benin in West Africa unit of Bread for the World. Nnimmo, we have already discussed this morning about the Clean Up Ogoni project, and I was listening again this evening to what you said, and I admit that I'm still struggling a little bit to really understand and grasp the idea how can this cleanup actually be done. first of all, I need to have an idea of... you were talking about the $1 billion, which is now available for the start, but is that really enough? If we look at the huge damage that has been done to the environment, I imagine that when you have soil being polluted up to a depth of 5 meters, it's not an easy thing to clean, and you certainly need more than buckets and rubber boots to do this. You will probably need very sophisticated machines, maybe even factories, who are doing this cleaning. So I wonder, first of all, is the 1 billion enough to do this job? And what actually is done to start the cleanup? This is not still clear for me.
1 billion is certainly not enough to do the cleanup, but it's just initial setting up the structure, commencing the training of the manpower that we needed, selecting the best technologies, what was going to be used to do the cleanup. And there are a lot of companies that have already made some submissions about both local and international companies about the methods they want to use. And I think the technical team in the project would have to assess what the possibilities are, seeing example what had been done elsewhere, and if this can actually be what would work. And yeah, then they'll be able to advise on what to use. And there will be examples. People have to do some practical demonstrations of the methods. It would be much easier, I think, to clean. Just if oil were just on surface of water, it's easy to skim them off. But in the swamps and in the soils, it's going to be quite difficult, I must say. It may depends on what is being used. It may require excavation and removal of soils. Or maybe there could be ways, I don't know, there could be other scientific ways of doing it. But a lot of questions will be asked before any particular method is selected.
So one or two questions are still possible, then we would wrap it up, at least the official part of it.
Hello, my name is Hester Samurai, and I did my master of law in international human rights and humanitarian law, and I wrote my master thesis about the responsibility of transnational cooperation at the example of Shell's engagement in the Niger Delta. I have a question for Sarah concerning the possible UN treaty on business and human rights. What do you think, how could such an accountability for transnational corporations look like? How could they held to account?
So I think the problem we're facing now is that we have human rights conventions that have a duty to protect for the states, but this duty to protect, or at least the way it's understood by the states, only applies to their territory. So states are supposed to regulate business operating in their country. And human rights organizations have been lobbying for a long time towards states to recognize that they also have a duty to make sure that businesses operating from their country abroad should also respect human rights. But at the moment, this is not being accepted by governments, and this leads to a legal gap. So what I think a treaty could do is fill this gap for operations that go across more than one country. So it could make clear that states have to regulate operations of their companies abroad, but it could also include provisions, for example, on how states have to cooperate in transnational cases. So often you have the problem that states are not cooperating. For example, when a court judgment is issued, it's very difficult to when you have a court judgment and you want to Vollstreckung execution of the judgment in the company's finances that is in another state. So that's, for example, a problem that Ecuador was facing in their Chevron case. So I think these are some of the gaps that could be filled by an international treaty. But I do also think that the treaty should clarify the state obligations in their own territory as well. So clarify how to offer effective access to remedies for people affected, clarify what sort of regulation should be in place for business. So yeah, these are the two aspects. Clarify what states should be doing to regulate business in their territory, but also fill the gaps that have arisen from transnational operations that are not being faced appropriately by states because businesses are operating over frontiers and are basically escaping accountability at the moment.
So last chance for the official part. No questions left for now. That's quite okay. Then we can end this in time. Actually, I have one last question for you, Nnimmo. You were talking about the practical difficulties of the cleanup. I wonder, and maybe that is a question that you can take home or to the science ministry too. The science ministry, the German science ministry, has a lot of cooperation with scientists in African countries. And a joint scientific project to find possible clean-up measures might be worthwhile, because in many countries, Germany is cooperating with sloppy oil drilling is happening, and it might be even happening in the future if we campaign for keeping it in the soil or not. So there will still be quite some use in having such technologies or knowledge put together in a joint venture. Again, a joint venture, but this time maybe on the more productive side. Do you already see something like that happening, like trying to figure out what is there? Or is it still so much in the beginning that this process did not even start yet? Or shall we again admire pictures of Shell with rubber boots and buckets?
Well, the pictures of Shell with rubber boots may... I hope they don't continue in other parts of the Niger Delta. And really, you know, my hope is that when the cleanup begins, then the oil companies will also sit up all over in the other oil fields, the productive oil fields, knowing that they cannot be using shovels. Because that's what they've been using, the best shovels, hoses, and very flimsy booms. In February this year, I went to visit, to see an oil spill. So it's almost like not tourism, but to inspect, to see what was being done. And they claimed, the company was Shell, they claimed to have cleaned up and to have devised the best system of containing the spill and cleaning everything. And then when we went to the location, they were using booms, rubber booms, that were not even able to stop the flow of the crude. Nothing at all. They would not do anything. And that was really horrible. So I believe the system, the cleanup, will use the best available systems to show good example, with the hope that that will influence how things are being done elsewhere. And people will also see the difference. If this is not done, then of course might as well just not waste everybody's time to clean them. Maybe we'll all move away from the Niger Delta and move to the Middle Belt, as somebody said in the documentary, while the people have been displaced by the desert are coming down, those displaced by oil will go up. Then everybody will meet in the middle, in Abuja. But I hope that doesn't happen. There are many methods for the cleanup that are currently being proposed by many interests. But I think that the technical crew that is being assembled, because they had to advertise for the position of the leadership of the project, hydrocarbon pollution remediation project, because that can be a political position as somebody with skill. So they would have to recommend the best possible ways of tackling the problem. So that hasn't happened yet.
Sarah, do you think that, you were mentioning Ecuador as one of the initiators of the new discussion process, and that probably has to do with the case you were already mentioning, the Chevron case. And that, of course, is so highly political that it is very difficult to convince other countries to step in. So what chances do you see to bring in at least one other country with another kind of credibility to make that process go on and broaden?
Yes, so you are completely right, and that's why we're trying to obviously get the process not to be only focused on this Chevron case, which is, yes, very political. And now at the second meeting at the United Nations, actually the European governments were at the table. So at the first meeting, they didn't even come. They said, look, we do not believe in binding standards. We believe in voluntary standards for business. And also, we will not join a process that is being led by Ecuador because they violate human rights all the time and we don't think it's credible. And I think that is not a position that European government should be taking in a process that has a majority of countries behind it. And so I'm very, I think it's a good step that they changed this position and that the European governments came to the discussion table now. And the next step will be for them to take a stronger role in this process. Because I think if European countries actually are serious about human rights protection, then this is a process that they should be celebrating and moving forward and putting their suggestions in and making it a credible process. And so that's what we hope will happen at the third meeting, but I cannot promise that because so far, the messages are a little bit divided coming from the European governments. They're still skeptical, I would say.
Okay, thank you very much. I learned a lot. I very much hope that in 5 years, when we meet again, you can tell us something about how the cleanup is going and that it is going.
We must see again in 5 years.
Why not?
Earlier.
Of course, I would like to see something happening in those 5 years. That is why I say in 5 years. If in 5 years nothing happened, then I would maybe give up hope. But, well,
we'll keep hope alive.
Exactly. So thank you very much. As Beate Aldorf at the beginning was already mentioning, we still are here for discussion. If anybody is interested in more bilateral exchange, that is possible downstairs. Thank you very much.